Hey guys, Philosopher here, and today I want to talk to you about what I saw firsthand in the Alliance War playtest. So first of all, I'm going to tell you what this was and who was involved in it. The NDA has been lifted, so I can share with you all the details of what I learned. And it was kind of disturbing, to be very blunt with you. So before actually I go through this, let me just tell you, it was essentially just the four or five largest alliances. I know my alliance was in it, Legion. I know Baby Yoda was in it. I think it may have been Wakanda instead of Smash House, but there was just four big alliances in it. We were all paired up and did wars. Ours, I think, was against Baby Yoda. And we didn't even have full participation in it. So, I don't think everybody could get all 24 of their members to care enough about a fake war. Which the developers, to be very blunt, were not happy about because they expected us to really care about their fake wars, and we didn't. But we really tested the features, and I was really unhappy with it. And I will tell you guys, the feedback to the devs was universally negative, and I, in particular, was very forceful with them about how BS some of the aspects of the war system are and how this is going to make it worse. And I will tell you this. I want to say this up front. I have been told by a dev since this, because I really am concerned. There's already a lot of players that are upset about the game, dissatisfied with the game. Alliance War is something that I think is universally liked, but there are bad aspects to it, right? Like where people are setting up alarm clocks in the middle of the night, and people all have to be online at the start or the end of the war, and when you get up to a certain level, and there's matchmaking issues where you have these unwinnable wars. Despite all that, people love this game mode, and I don't want to see them screw it up. But I am told by a dev that the Alliance War changes will not go in live the way that they are here. He said, I do not have to be concerned about that. So one thing I will just say is you may have heard people telling you to make changes to your roster based on what we've seen in this playtest. And I would be very hesitant about doing that because I've been told by a dev that there's going to be substantial changes. They heard our feedback, but I want to show you this so you can get a sense of what happened and what we're reacting to. So first of all, and I want to thank, by the way, Barack Obama of Sigma Cluster for compiling this list. I have to tell you, I originally made a video where I just ranted about the changes, and I didn't have all the details. He wrote down all the details, so kudos to him. I did not. I just participated in it, and I did write down a lot of the analysis that I did, but not all of the details. So here are the changes. We'll go through this, and then I'll give you my analysis. So first of all, up in the playtest, you could purchase up to two extra slots for war, increasing the slot count from 8 to 10. And what you are using to do those purchases in the game were the Alliance credits that you use for Stark Tech, which itself is a big problem, okay? Because it's really something that only experienced players have a lot of. So, for example, if you look here, I only have 670 of these things, and it's because I haven't maxed out my Stark Tech. Now, and this is one of the longest grinds in the game. It takes years to get there. And, at least well over a year. I've been playing 16, 17 months, and I still have a ways to go. And you can't, you can't even whale out to make this faster. Now, there are some players, of course, who have been spending their star credits in this part. When I did the DD4 race, I was racing against people who were beating me in part because they had tons of this stuff saved up and they were able to, get their war credits and elite war credits, which is fine. What I will say is that, you may want to save this, but, based upon what the devs have told me, it sounds like that none of this is going to be going in the former. It's going to be substantially changed. We'll see if they're telling me the truth or not, but that's what I've been told. But nonetheless, that's what you spend it on. So here's the thing. First of all, so this in and of itself is what it is, but you realize that on its face, then just this alone means you're going to spend more time doing war, right? It's more screen time. It's more time in the game, and because your war is going to be longer. You got to clear 10 rooms instead of 8. Like in my level of war, in a lot of levels of war, right? Once you hit Platinum 1, Platinum 2, you're full clearing the other side a lot of times. Particularly now at Infinity Watch, those days of Heroes for Hire and a bazillion defense wins are over. We're back to where it was, where people are full clearing. Well, now, after you know, the full clear is going to take a lot longer, right? You've got 20% more or whatever, right? Or 25% more rooms. You go from 8 to 10. Here's the thing, though. This is another silly spot thing of this. Basically, every change was pretty silly here. Very little of it was good. The new slots don't earn points, but do earn war and currency. So this is great. So, you know, I'm sure everyone in their alliance is that guy who cares so much about winning MVP that he won't make the attacks you need to make for the team, but instead sits back and tries to, like, get the biggest ones to get MVP score. Well, now that guy's not going to attack two of the slots in every room or four of the slots, right, because each side will have two of them, because they don't earn him points for his MVP score. That's going to be an absolute nightmare if that went live, okay? Then they took the bridge buffs off, which is just that stupid counter thing, and then they're replaced. That's cargo bay buffs are on bridge, but cargo bay is different now. And why is cargo bay different? Well, cargo bay is different because what they've done is they removed cargo bay buffs and replaced them with 20% for all stats for all war ready characters. So what they call war ready, it's just their Scopal Neck's name for having ISO 4 green, like a four, you know, ISO level 4 green ISO on your characters. So in case you didn't get the message already that they were going to shove ISO down your throat and force you to get it on your characters, you know, it just shows that they really weren't paying attention at all. You know, of course, because, you know, before people were like, well, Doom Raids, I want, you know, now I'm stuck ISOing up my characters. So now basically every war character you got to bring up to ISO 4 because this is such a big buff that you kind of have to have it, right? And this is basically their way of forcing you to do this for your whole roster. What I will say is that this also had some really unexpected negative impact in general, which is debuffs weren't landing a lot at all. I mean, we had all these problems where battles that usually are predictable aren't predictable because what was happening was, you know, there was just too much resistance on characters and so forth. It was actually, it ended up being there's a lot of defense wins, not because of, you know, anything other than just these buffs were just so significant. The characters were so beefy that it just made it where, like, your debuffs weren't landing. So, you know, it may be that everyone's starting to use Skirmisher just to land their debuffs, that sort of thing. I didn't like this either. Then Hanger also gets 10% all stats for war-ready characters. Like I said, it's just, it ends up being, even more important to go fast and get globals down. So at a higher levels in war, the higher level you get in war, the strategy is all about rushing to get these global rooms down before the enemy gets your global rooms down, right? Right now, you're rushing to get Armory Hound, Hanger down, so the other side has the disadvantage when they're attacking, you know, or you're trying to get whatever, Medbay Barracks, this sort of thing. Well, here, now there's two, you know, Hanger's even more important, and Cargo Bay is another one, so there's another global room, and you're essentially 30% all stats. That's a lot of additional buffs for your characters, right? And then, of course, to do this, they give you more war energy. So you get another war energy. And you're allowed to attack three slots at a time instead of two. So here's the thing, guys. You know, some of you may be like, okay, that's cool. There's more defense slots, more attacks, more war. I like war. Well, here's the deal. Right now, there's four global buff rooms. You need 96 attacks to get them down plus security. So that basically means if you have 16 people on at the start, if everyone purchases the additional tax and doesn't lose, they can do it. Now you need 100, and with these changes, you needed 140 attacks because you have five global buff rooms, and that can only be accomplished with 24 people on at the start, and everyone plays full, buys full, and everyone makes no mistakes, doesn't lose. Essentially, you know, what this does is this is going to make wars longer. It's going to mean your activity is going to be even more important, etc. Because now you can clear 150% faster. You can clear three slots at a time instead of two. So the war, what ended up happening is we had to be online more, attacking to race to get these buff rooms down. And then you're failing on the, you know, because there's so much resistance and stuff on these characters that they're resisting and so forth. It ended up just being a crap show, so to speak. It's YouTube's family friendly. I won't say the word that comes to mind, but it's going the absolute opposite way that things need to go. And I was so forceful about this, and I was just very blunt. And here's the deal. As I explained to Scopely in this stupid playtest, we all have lives. We have, or at least most of us, we have jobs, we have families. You should not be in a situation where your kid's got a soccer game, but you've got to be on your phone because it's the start of war or the end of war or the arena timer or whatever. That is stupid. This is a mobile game. It also should not be the case that you're in a meeting at work, but you're rushing out of your meeting to, you know, get on your phone because your alliance is pinging you. You need to be there for the energy drop or whatever. That's silly. Okay, there are other games out there like Galaxy Heroes where I have 24 hours to make my attacks, and I can make them anytime in the 24 hours, and it doesn't matter. And the winning is based on efficiency, not based on who goes faster. And one of the devs admitted to me that they love this race thing and they think that's a great aspect of their game. It is neat, but it is not worth giving up our lives for. They need to make this game more friendly for players and more able to be something where you can pick this game up when you have the time to play it, not be online 24/7 playing this game. It is not good for players. It is not good for this game. And they're just going to burn out players. And so war could be really fun if they made it, you know, you could make your attacks whenever and it didn't really matter when you made them. But when you did, you had to make the most efficient attacks ever. So your characters were at full health, or you used four characters to beat five, or other things that they did to increase the challenge level for us and to demonstrate your game knowledge, instead of having it be all about who has the most activity, who can coordinate the most, who can go the fastest. I've learned how to play this game, this war game that they have, but it is not good. It's not sustainable. It's not something that works for people with real lives and real jobs and real families. So very unhappy with the playtest. You should be very concerned because this is going to make issues with war even worse. But the good news supposedly is that it's not actually coming. So don't, you know, change your life around based on what's going to happen here. I had one player ask me, maybe I can go back to zone one now because the wars are going to go longer with these playtest changes. No. They supposedly aren't going to implement them, but if they do, I do think this is a very bad thing for the game. All right, guys, if you like this video, I'm sure none of you like this video because it's not a positive thing, but hey, if you like the channel, smash that like button, subscribe to this channel, check out our Twitch feed. That's below. I stream most weeknights. And then also check out our Discord. That's below. Give me your thoughts. If you think that this is a good thing or a bad thing for war, give me your thoughts below or put them on our Discord. I always love reading and discussing with all of you.